Welcome to our next study on the book of Proverbs. We're talking about friendship and relationship, Dan.
We are.
Yes, and a huge topic.
It is. It's big because it something that impacts all of us all the time, right? I mean, we're all in relationships on a constant basis, and so think of every relationship that you have can be benefited by this study.
Absolutely. And so we could go in a lot of different directions. We could talk about parents and their children. We could about work relationships. We can talk about different friendships that we have. But I think as we work our way through talking about friendship, basically, it's going to hit every relationship. You can apply those principles.
You can. And just remember that the book of Proverbs is written to teach us how to live skillfully.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the way that God has designed us to. But that's the idea of like wisdom is living skillfully in the world that God has created. So this is how do we navigate difficult and wonderful relationships in an artful way.
Right. And this is really important for believers because we are righteous with God, which means we've been brought into a right relationship with Him, mm-hmm. which is our vertical relationship is right with Him. Now God wants our horizontal relationships to be right. And so it matters. And for many of us, we've been doing life the way we've been doing it, and it hasn't been working. Our relationships are fractured or they're frayed. Mm-hmm. Yes, frayed. We had a rough start this morning.
Yeah.
But it's getting better.
Frayed.
And for many of us, like, who cares? We should care. In all of these things, we want to live skillfully in our relationship with one another. And as believers today, the relationships that we're in, we should live peaceably.
Right.
As much as that's in us, Romans chapter 12 tells us. And so it's really important that we look at what we're talking about today. And if there are areas that we're convicted about in our relationships with our friends, our family, our other believers in Christ, then it's incumbent upon us to really take these verses, meditate upon them, and allow God to begin to change us so our relationships and friendships are right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 1 John tells us that it's really the horizontal relationships that are indications of how our relationship with God truly is.
Yes.
So we can't pretend like we love God if we don't love our brothers. And so this is one of those things that maybe we've been impacted by culture in many ways about how relationships and friendships are supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And let's step back and then go to the Word and say, God, what do you want? What do you think is important? How should we?
Yes. And I think, Dan, from the points that you gave me already, we're going to see how important friendships are.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like friendship has taken a back seat in our self-focused, self-centered world today.
Yeah.
And I think especially with men.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think the other thing that happens is that we begin to prize quantity, right? Like,
yes.
How many friends do you have on Facebook? How many likes do you get on this page? And nobody is talking about like who's got a friend who's going to be there with them at all times, who's loyal to them, who is lifelong, and that those are the relationships that actually matter.
Right. Dan, how many true friends do you think you have? I put you on the spot.
Yeah. That is tough. I think I've been very blessed. Mm-hmm. I think that you're blessed to have one or two.
Yeah.
I think I have four or five.
I don't think four and five are really that close to you.
No?
No. I think you have one.
Okay.
No, I don't know.
No. You might be right.
No, I don't even know who they are. I was thinking about that. And I think like when I talk about friendships, like people that I would bare my soul to, mm-hmm. I have probably three in my life that I think are close enough that I would tell them anything. And we all need that.
Yeah.
We need at least one.
Mm-hmm.
So, Dan, speaking of quality over quantity, Proverbs has much to say on this point.
It does. Yeah, there's lots of verses. And so maybe we can look at a few of them.
Okay.
Proverbs chapter 19, verse 4 says, wealth makes many friends, but the poor is separated from his friend. And then other translations say that the poor is deserted by his friends. And the idea there is just that it is possible to be in a situation where people want to be your friend and you have like all of these friends,
mm-hmm.
but it's not a beneficial thing. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, a man who has friends must show himself friendly. But another way of saying that is a man who has many companions will come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer to a brother.
Hmm.
And that the picture is just, you can have a lot of friends or tons of people around you that would call you a friend, but those aren't real friends.
Yeah, it's a shame.
And that can actually drive you to ruin because you're having all these voices and nobody that's really close.
Right. And they're actually using you for whatever reason. And that's a shame.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of relationships like that today.
There is. And we got a great example of the story of the prodigal son who was used in relationships.
And when it all fell apart, they were gone.
They were gone.
So he had quantity, but not quality.
Yeah. I think another place we see this in the book of Proverbs is when Solomon is warning his son against against harlots.
Yeah.
That he's like, the idea is that there is a way of having a cheap version of this,
mm-hmm.
and it will give momentary pleasure. But then in Proverbs 5, verse 15, he says, drink water from your own well, share your love with your wife. And then it says, let your wife be the fountain of blessing for you, rejoice in the wife of your youth. And all that, the idea is like, just pour into the one woman that God's given you.
Yes.
And so maybe we should be pouring into the friendships, the close friendships we have, the wife that we have, and trying to make those wonderful, beautiful things rather than being so concerned about trying to get the cheap version of it from.
Yeah, and I think the cheap version is easy. So many people complain about their relationships, like especially husbands and wives. And if you would take the time and invest in that relationship, as much as you complain about it or think about having a different one, it could change your relationship in a wonderful way.
Good. I remember as a kid, you'd have times where like somebody was your friend, and then all of a sudden there was a cooler kid around. And that kid is gone.
Yeah.
Like all of a sudden, right. They're best friends with that person, and you've been hanging out with them for a few years, but that doesn't really matter. I think that kind of like disloyalty and that like, I'm going to move on to the best friend whenever, you know, the coolest, right. newest friend.
Right. So it's not even friendship.
No.
Again, you were being used. I was never in the situation because I was never cool.
No, you were probably the coolest friend that everyone was leaving.
No, that's not true.
Leaving me for.
All right. So point number two. Love is proven in difficulties,
mm-hmm.
like true friendship, even piggybacking off your last point.
Right.
When hard times come, who's left standing with you?
Right. Proverbs 27:10 says, do not forsake your own friend or your father's friend, nor go to your brother's house in the day of your calamity. Better is a neighbor nearby than a brother far away.
Hmm.
And the picture is that it's like, obviously the idea then is that the brother is not doing what they're supposed to do. The brother has forsaken you in the day of calamity, but the neighbor is there.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's better to have a relationship where the person is there in difficult times.
Yes, absolutely. And the fact is, we think about difficulties, and for many of us, when something happens to someone we love, we have this tendency to move away because we don't know what to do or what to say, but it's exactly in those times we should move toward them, mm-hmm. and if you don't know what to say, say nothing, just show up.
The presence is huge.
How many times we've been in a situation, either in a hospital or sitting with a family, that we couldn't tell you what we said because very little was said,
mm-hmm.
but for them, it was life-changing because someone was there for them.
Right. It is, and it does seem like it's those really difficult times that bring people closer together. Like you get to form relationships in difficulty that they're not formed
any other way. Suffering.
Yeah.
If you enter into suffering, if you really love someone and you're willing to enter into their suffering, you will have a bond that's mm-hmm. stronger than anything you could ever believe.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing.
Right.
I don't want to go on rabbit trails, but I used to do chaplain stuff in Saginaw, and I remember going to a case where a woman lost her son. He was actually executed. I showed up there. I went through all the trial stuff with them, and the fact is, they loved me, and we had a relationship because mm-hmm. we entered into that suffering together.
Mm-hmm.
And that should be the church, that when they're suffering, we have people that we enter into it, and our love is proved in those difficult times.
I think you do that really well.
Well, thank you.
You enter into people's suffering, yeah. Okay, so that's a point. I think another, just to go along with that idea, Proverbs 17:17 says a brother is born for adversity. A friend loves at all times. I got that mixed up. But the idea that is a friend is always there and just is there to love. But sometimes the difficulty is actually sin. And so then how do you deal with sin when your brother or someone offends you?
Right, because real love is not enabling them to continue in that action. Real love sometimes is saying no.
Yes. Absolutely. And sometimes I think too, what we can do is we can take an offense and we can either blow it up
mm-hmm.
and like tell the world. And that's actually chapter 17, verse 9 says, whoever covers an offense seeks love, but he who repeats a matter separates close mm-hmm. friends. So you can either like tell the world about this and destroy that friendship, or you can keep that quiet. But then it's not a good thing not to deal with it.
Right.
And we'll probably talk more about dealing with problems in the next one. But I think that dealing with issues with our friends is a really big deal.
Yeah, and I think some of this is maybe the reason we don't deal with issues is because we don't have the friendship that we thought we had.
Mm-hmm.
Like we've not done life enough together to really be able to pour into people mm-hmm. and tell them the truth about where they're at, because that's difficult.
Yeah.
But it needs to be done.
Mm-hmm. Do you know, there's a funny Proverbs in 20, Proverbs 19:18. It's kind of, it shocks you at first, but mm-hmm. I think it speaks to this. It says, discipline your son, for there is hope. Do not set your heart on putting him to death. Okay, so the picture is a father who is so frustrated with his children that he rather them be gone, like put to death, but just like, I don't want any part of this anymore. And the proverb, the wisdom, is to know discipline because there's still hope. And right. I think you apply it to all relationships. Like when difficulty comes and when they're being bad, when they've done the wrong thing, maybe the right thing to do is try to help them correct it and be an influence for good in their life rather than just, I wish they were gone. I wish they were dead.
Dan, I think that point is really pertinent in church relationships. Sometimes we think, I just don't want to touch you anymore because you've blown it again. We have to remember that their story is not finished yet. Mm-hmm. And this might be an opportunity to lovingly speak truth into their life. And not just, it's easy to disregard people. Yep. Remember that episode we had in the church years and years ago where two women were in a fight and we brought them in the office. By the way, if you're fighting in our church, you'll be brought into the office. And we said, listen, this has to be right. And the one woman said, it's okay. I'm just not going to talk to you anymore.
I think it was like, no, we talked about it before we came in here. We just decided we're going to avoid each other forever. Right.
That's not love. That's not the church. Mm-hmm. So don't do that.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Another verse, and this is really good.
Okay.
It speaks to that. Proverbs 27:5. So first it says, open rebuke is better than love carefully concealed. Mm-hmm. So you think about that. I don't think the idea there is that open, like rebuke somebody in front of a bunch of people.
Yes.
I think it's talking to somebody about a difficulty
yes.
is better than pretending like you're being loving by concealing the issues that are really there.
Right.
Because the very next verse says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful.
Yes.
And the idea is that friends will wound at times, but for your good.
That's right. When you have this idea that, well, I'm not going to say anything to them because I love them too much. Mm-hmm. The person that you love most is you mm-hmm. because you don't want them to be upset with you. You don't want them to misunderstand you. And so your love is really not right. You're loving yourself more than the other person.
Right. And just recognizing that all good relationships will be painful at times. And that's part of a good relationship.
Amen. People jump out of marriages because pain happens, or if they would have stayed in and watched the fruit of the healing and the process, they'd be much more, they'd be stronger in their relationship where they just jumped out of it.
Right. I remember in a sermon once you talked about how the person who can make you the most angry is the one that you love the most.
Yeah.
And I remember using that, telling Bailey, like, well, hey, Bailey, the reason you're so angry at me is just because you love me so much.
she wasn't buying that, though.
She wasn't buying it at the time. But I do think that Martin Luther King said, there can be no deep disappointment where there is not deep love.
Mm,
and right. So that means that in friendships, there will be at times disappointment. And it's not time to move on. It's time to make things right and work.
And do the hard work. It's worth it.
Yeah.
Number three. Friends affect who we are.
Yeah, they do.
And this has been a mantra for me. Show me who your friends are, and I will show you who you'll become.
Yes,
absolutely true. Always.
I think that sermon was exactly preached when I was at camp as an 18-year-old by someone else.
But yeah.
It was the exact, show me who your friends are, and I'll show you who you're going to be.
That there's no way around it, because our friends do influence us for good or for bad.
Mm-hmm. Proverbs 13:20. He who walks with wise men will be wise.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a future tense, right? So you don't have to be wise to walk with wise men, but you will be.
Absolutely.
If you continue to. But the companion of fools will be destroyed.
Yeah.
And you just follow them into the destruction.
We do. The Proverbs has a lot to say, because we talked about anger and talked about going with an angry man, you become angry.
Yeah.
So it shows us that the temperament of the people we hang around and what's valuable to them becomes valuable to us.
Right. That verse that you just mentioned about the angry man, the next verse says, lest you learn his ways and set a snare for your soul. And I think that's what can happen.
Yeah.
And there's a verse in Proverbs 28:7 that talks about being a companion of gluttons, shaming your father. And 29:3 says, a companion of harlots wastes his wealth. So we just, like, when you join yourself to people who are against God, who are going the wrong way, then you bring shame and dishonor, and you waste your life, and you set a snare for your soul, and ultimately you become like them.
Exactly. I think Paul talks to Timothy in 2 Timothy about pursuing all these things with those who have a pure heart, reminding them that if you want to be spiritual, you got to be around spiritual people. If you're around worldly people, you become worldly. Mm-hmm. There's no way around it.
Mm-hmm. And probably the ultimate verse for that is Proverbs 27:17. As iron sharpens iron, so doth a man sharpen the countenance of his friend.
That's exactly right.
So we can be a force for good in the lives of our friends.
Amen. Awesome. Right. And Dan, one more point on this idea of friendship.
I think just the power of good relationships, that we can recognize that there is beauty in wonderful relationships, and there's also poison in bad ones. And so when we think about this topic and we try to figure out how we're going to try and live this out, just recognize that so many of the gifts that God has given us come in the way of friends and children and wives and church family and even neighbors. Like, you can create relationships that bring a lot of joy. One just for the wife, Proverbs 12:4 says, an excellent wife is a crown of her husband, but she who causes shame is like rottenness in his bones. And you get both of that, like this, you know? So you get to be that in others' lives as well. It's not just a matter of like, hey, seek the right thing for yourself so you can be, you know, have a crown.
You should be this type of person so that you are bringing health and beauty to the lives of other people. And what a journey that would be if that was our mantra. That's like, I want to make sure that when people are in contact with me and we interact, that they leave feeling loved, encouraged, more spiritual, not like they're emotional vampires. You know, where people just suck the life out of you?
Yep.
We can actually bring life. And so there is power in good relationships. I think we've all, I hope you've experienced that. I have friends, when I talk to them, I feel excited about the work of the Lord. I feel encouraged. I feel if I'm weary, just to go on again. There are people I call like that encourage me. And so those are the types of friends we ought to be.
Yeah. And there's people you pray with, and all of a sudden, like, it feels like God is there again. And it's a wonderful thing. So find people in your life who bring you up, and then be that for other people.
Amen. And the sphere that will be most helpful in this area is the Church of Jesus Christ. Yeah. You should be knowing and loving and encouraging and being a friend and getting friends here. It will change your life. Mm-hmm. It will change your life.
The design of the church by God reminds us that we are meant to be in community, and we're designed to be in relationships. And it is through those relationships that God grows and changes and works.
Yes. And the reason we move away from it is because they're hard. Mm-hmm. They're hard, or they expose us, and we want to run from that. But if we'd stay put and allow God to work through the lives of others, we would see tremendous change in our lives.
Yeah. A lot of times those relationships are like the sandpaper.
They are.
I was talking to a man today, and I think he's well-meaning. But he's a man who doesn't attend a church anywhere, and he just listens to YouTube or podcasts all the time. And so he's got everything figured out. He knows how everything's going to happen, you know, at the end of times, and he's got it all sorted out. But there's no relationships that he has with other Christians that are helping to like rough out those edges and try and mold him into the like character and the person that God wants him to be. There's a whole lot of head knowledge up here, and even in the head knowledge, we don't understand that, like, if we just pursue what we want to believe and we don't have other people pushing against that, like we had in our Sunday school classes, then we just go off into wherever we want to go, and it's really good for us to have other people being like, no brother, here's a verse, no sister, have you considered this?
We think holiness comes in seclusion. It doesn't. Monasteries are a bad idea. Holiness comes in real life and dealing with people, because that's how God exposes our weaknesses and our strengths in our life. Mm-hmm. So be a good friend.
Yes.
And whatever changes you need to make, remember, this is meditative literature. Meditate on these verses that speak to your heart. Mm-hmm. Get them deep within, and then work them out in your life. Mm-hmm. And so be a good friend.
All right.
All right. We should close in prayer, Dan.
We should. It's my turn.
Yes, sir.
Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you that Christ presents himself as the friend of sinners. Mm-hmm. And so we get this ultimate example of what it means to be a friend, to sacrifice for others and to put their needs in front of yours. And Lord, I thank you that you are our friend. Mm-hmm. And considering that, Lord, I pray that you'd help us then to be friends to others who drive them toward you. Mm-hmm. Lord, who help them in their walk. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to seek friendships that would help us walk with our Savior. Yeah. And Lord, we thank you for all relationships, not just friendships, but your gift of marriage and your gift of children and neighbors and employees and employers and all these areas. Lord, I pray that we would consider our lives and what we're doing with them now and how we can better glorify you in these places. And we thank you and we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right. Enjoy the study.
Yep.